From the morning, we are discussing the things from a philosophical point of view. What I am going to discuss is not so deeper things. I am reflecting more from the sociological point of view about education in Indian tradition. Learning is liberation, as you all know, that's a very famous dictum from Vishnu Puran. Sa vidya ya vimoktai. Learning leads to liberation. In the beginning, I have quoted some lines from E.F. Schumacher, and I will start with that. He is talking about the problems of modern education. An economist talking about the problems of education. The problems of education are merely reflections of the deepest problems of our age. They cannot be solved by organization, administration, or the expenditure of money, even though the importance of all these are not denied. We are suffering from a metaphysical disease, and the cure, therefore, must be metaphysical. Education which fails to clarify our central convictions is merely training or indulgence. For it is our central convictions that are in disorder, and as long as the present entometaphysical temper persists, the disorder will grow worse. Does it not appear ironically strange that when almost all makers of our education policy and programs are bent upon making education a human resource for economic growth, an economist and almost of first order is hinting towards some other direction? He wants to bring it to our attention that education is a manifestation of philosophy of life a society believes in and of values it aspires to. I would like to prefer term vidya, learning. When we use the term education, the educator becomes the real subject and the educatee becomes the receiving end or adopt a passive role, while in learning process the learner is a real or active subject. Sa vidya ya vimuktai means learning leads to liberation. This dictum from Vishnu Puran not only defines the real purpose of our true learning or education, but encompasses all the other aspects as well. Let me make it clear, as Rohit hinted some time back, that this dictum Vishnu Puran is actually referring to some spiritual mukti or liberation. But from the sociological point of view, what a mukti is, that I have to discuss in this. What does the dictum mean? Whose liberation is it? And from what and unto what? And why is learning a process of liberation? How could it achieve its goal? All these themes of Indian traditions have discussed the concept of vidya or learning in much detail. You can delete the word learning if you do not think it proper as a synonym of vidya. Vedic, Buddhist and Jain, all these philosophical traditions talk of mukti, nirvana or kevalya or liberation or salvation as the final goal of human life. But what is the nature and cause of the bondage that all these traditions aspire to be liberated from? It is the liberation from illusion or avidya. Again, the problem of translation. I don't know if illusion or ignorance is the real meaning of avidya. The real bondage is avidya, which is generally translated as ignorance or illusion in English. But the real meaning of avidya would be not knowing the innate or essential nature or dharma of any phenomena. Dharma is the innate or essential nature of any phenomena. The characteristics perceived at the surface are not illusions. Practically they are there. But these are not necessarily the essential nature of the perceived. Vidya, therefore, is to know this essential nature. Jain philosophy believes that reality is perceived in many forms and aspects, namely mukti, that is knowledge from sense perceptions and inference, shruti, knowledge from received from others, that is testimony, avadhi, knowledge by clairvoyance, manaparyaya, direct knowledge of thoughts of others, and keval, that is perfect knowledge, comprehending all substances and their modifications. It is to be noted that in Jain philosophy, the jiva is actually jnana swarupa, is pure consciousness. Reality has many layers and dimensions, and knowledge of these is not ignorance, but to know the reality with all its layers and dimensions while realizing its essential nature is vidya or true knowledge. The Vedic and Buddhist traditions also speak of vidya or avidya almost in the same, broadly in the same voice. When one's mental disposition, behavior, relationships and actions are guided by this vidya or true knowledge, only then he can be liberated from the bondage of avidya and its effects as vidya. As vidya in tradition is not information about truth. This is the difference between the general concept of knowledge and vidya. It is not information about truth, but realizing or experiencing it. Even a great logician like Shankaracharya affirms that experience, anubhuti, is true jnana or knowledge. But any kind of knowing is influenced by the position or mental disposition of the knower or the subject. Hence, to know one's real self becomes a precondition for the true knowledge. It is therefore in the fitness of the Indian scheme of education or learning process that its first and foremost goal is to know the self in all his dimensions and layers with his essential nature or dharma. Who is this knower? Is he an individual biological being, a biopsychological being, or a socio-economic being, or some spiritual being? What are his relationships with other beings and the universe? What is the meaning and purpose of his being a human being? Indian tradition defines an individual human being and his goals of life in Indian sociology through concepts of rena, rena mukti. Rena means debt, owing something. Rena mukti, paying off the debts, and purusartha. Every human being is indebted to certain indebtors for his existence, generally consciousness. Jnana or knowledge or vidya is an experience of oneness of the knower and the knowable. The real goal of learning or education in Indian tradition is to prepare oneself to realize one's real role and relations in the social as well as in the cosmic scheme of existence through personal, professional and socio-cultural activities in one's future life. This is the real swadharma leading to liberation. Commenting upon the concept of swadharma in Gita, Sri Aurobindo remarks the child's education ought to be an outbringing of all that is best, most powerful, most intimate and living in his nature, the mold into which the man's actions and development ought to run is that of his innate quality and power. He must acquire new things, but he will acquire them best, most vitally on the basis of his own developed type and inborn force. And so too, the functions of a man ought to be determined by his natural turn, gift, and capacities. The individual who develops freely in this manner will be a living soul and mind and will have a much greater power for the service of the race. And he in this context has also remarked, from this emphasis on the inner truth and not on outer forms arises the spiritual significance or power which Gita assigns for the following of Swadharma. A human being has, besides his debts and obligations, certain biopsychological, socio-economic, aesthetic, cultural, and spiritual needs and aspirations as well. To have a happy and fulfilled liberated life, these needs and aspirations are to be realized, and any true learning or education cannot ignore it. Purusartha theory in Indian tradition classifies these in four categories. Namely, we all know that, namely, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Dharma is essential nature of social relationship or ethics here, as without justice and mutuality, no social organization can maintain itself. John Rawls has truly remarked that justice is the first virtue of any social organization. There may be some competition or conflict, but violation of certain code of ethics and justice is not permissible. The individual human being, while pursuing his calm and earth aspirations, must respect the individuality and just needs and aspirations of others, and is expected also to assist them in their realization of the same. Education or learning is a process through which this mutuality and respect for justice could be cultivated, not as some imposed values, but as some innate seed of human beings. That is why when Bhima in Mahabharata war drinks the blood of Kauravas to have his vow of revenge fulfilled, he is condemned not only by his enemies but by his allies, friends and family members also, because this action is considered inhuman and against the ethics of war and justice. Education is a kind of cultivation, as culture itself actually is. And the cultivated instincts, which are called secondary instincts by psychologists like Eric Fromm, become more decisive in the human history and progress than the biological instincts. Darwin himself comes to comment in his Descent of Man that a sense of ethics and sociality naturally emerges with the evolutionary process when life transforms itself into human form. Social instincts like love, friendship, justice, responsibility, etc. are new innate instincts owing to historical evolution, and any process of education by inculcating these in the individual and community is expected to play an active part in the evolutionary process of history. Vidya, or to know the dharma or innate nature of self and its relationship with all types of other, not only theoretically but in its applied form, is therefore the purpose of education in Indian tradition. The aim of education was not a concept only. Evangelist has rightly said that the declared agenda is not as significant as the hidden one, which is realized through the process and institutionalization of education. We must therefore examine the institutionalization of the Indian education system to understand the reality of its hidden agenda. First thing that attracts our attention in Indian system of education is the centrality of the learner. The responsibility of moral and intellectual development of learner's personality was entrusted to the guru or teacher who was expected to recognize learner's genius or talent through which later could possibly realize his real self and the role he is to perform in life to attain mukti. The educational institutions enjoyed complete autonomy irrespective of the demands of the state or market. Each gurukul or ashram had its own resources in the form of agricultural land or its revenue and the livestock. Every student, irrespective of his caste or class, was to live in the same way, treated equally, and was required to perform the same kind of duties, including physical labor, and take an active part in activities related to agriculture, cattle breeding, and other domains. All students, P. Prabhu has written a very good book on Hindu social organization, and talking about the education, he says, all students, comments Prabhu, has the same status with reference to each other, and every one of them had to observe the same rules of discipline and of simple living. A sense of equality, a feeling for respect for physical labor, and a habit of simple living and respect for non-human beings and nature as well were cultivated in the students. These are the preconditions for a mind that adores principle of oneness of life, equality, and justice. Actually, education in Indian tradition puts first emphasis on the evolution of mind, which leads to dharma. Efficiency in the professional skills and informational knowledge come next, because it appears to believe that understanding and efficiency in the desired field are bound to come if the mental faculties are satisfactorily developed. Educational process was designed in three stages. There was some talk about this in the last session also. Educational process was designed in three stages, namely Shravana, Manan, and Nididhyasan. In the first stage, the learner listens to Guru. Today, to know something from a written text may be included here. While in the second stage of Manan, the student is required to ponder over the lesson, attempting to solve the possible questions and problems by himself, as well as by discussing the same with the Guru to comprehend it fully. Upanishads highly appreciate this questioning and debating with the teacher. Even Shankaracharya says that knowledge can only be obtained by investigation. There are many examples where the Guru, when he does not feel himself competent enough to answer the question, sends his pupil to some other expert, and sometimes he himself approaches more knowledgeable person to solve the problem which the student or the pupil puts before him. In Chandogya Upanishad, Uddalak Aruni, with his son Swet Ketu, approaches Javali to inquire about rebirth. In another episode, he leads five Brahmans to King Aswapati to know about universal soul. Various schools of philosophical thought supply ample testimony that an environment of free discussion and difference of opinion was not discouraged. In the third stage of learning, that is Nididhyasan, the learner is expected to experience the truth or the real nature of the concerned subject himself by practicing it, by applying it. This experience is the removal of avidya, or attaining real vidya or knowledge. But while studying any subject, the learner is expected to learn to attempt to fulfill his non-academic obligations as well. Only then his learning or education could be considered satisfactorily completed. Only then he could be expected to engage in his pursuit of in the field of kama and artha in a way that could lead to moksha or liberation. Here, we need some discussion on the concept of moksha or mukti, because it is misleading. Sometimes we think that this concept of mukti is a purely some spiritual, which has nothing to do with the human life. Here we need some discussion on the concept of moksha or mukti. Moksha, no doubt, is a spiritual category, but its domain encompasses the whole human field. Can one attain moksha in this earthly life? The answer is positive. moksha or liberation is actually transcending one's narrow ego and its complexes. When one transcends it, there emerges a feeling of oneness or sameness of life. The duality of the self and the other is extinguished. Speaking of the characteristics of or lakshana of a liberated being, Mahabharata declares this quote: "One perceiving his self in all beings and all beings in his self, he attains the highest consciousness." Living with the knowledge that others have in them the same soul as he has in him, he lives in a consciousness that is beyond death. Again, one more sloka: "Perceiving his oneness with others," and this is also from Mahabharata, "perceiving his oneness with others and thus their togetherness, who is a friend to all, has disciplined his senses, does not seek recognition and acclaims, is free of pride, such a person is always liberated." It is also to be noted that even to attain moksha in the pure spiritual sense, that is being one with the Absolute, one is required to attain this feeling of oneness or sameness of life or existence, and for that any process of learning or education is expected to evolve this attribute in the student and teacher both. It would be a fallacy if we, through this discussion, have developed a perception that aim of Indian education concentrates only on spiritual dimension. No spirituality is genuine if it does not trickle down to the daily mundane life. If you go through the list of academic disciplines and professional skills, we can easily see that it encircles almost all the required fields of knowledge which were considered useful in the time and place concerned. But in any case, whether it was an academic or professional one, the training in character building, remarks Prabhu, proceeded side by side with the development of the intellect of the student. The moral culture of the student was not separable from his intellectual culture. It is to be noted that the above analysis is true not only for ancient India, but it worked broadly up to the pre-British period. The research done by Dharampal, named The Beautiful Tree, speaks a lot about prevalence of this tradition at least up to the beginning of 19th century, and happily, the research is based solely upon the surveys and documents prepared by officers of the East India Company, not by any Indian scholar. This is the time when British rule started interfering, and its educational as well as revenue policy destroyed the traditional educational structure, and with it was forgotten the philosophy upon which it was built. Dharampal's research also demolished the perception that the education was not allowed to Sudraj or so-called lower castes. No doubt, study of Vedic rites and recitation was only for Brahmins, as it required years of rigorous and complex training. And we must admit that this restriction to study our most sacred text gradually resulted in the exclusion of a section of society, the so-called untouchables. That was very unfortunate, and it should not have been made, I think. But all other branches of knowledge, including reading Gita, was accessible to all. He gives a list not only of Sudra students, but also teachers from that stratum of society. Even that list is prepared on the basis of the surveys conducted by East India Company. What was the position of education in India before they started their educational policy? They made great surveys in Bengal Presidency, in Madras Presidency, in Bombay Presidency, in Punjab even. And these surveys were analyzed and discussed by Dharampal. And they all are present in the book. All the documents relating to the surveys are there in the book. He only writes a introduction to the book. And his conclusions are in the introduction. So he gives a list not only of Sudra students but also of teachers from that strata of society. Even in ancient tradition, any person by following his professional righteously could attain ultimate knowledge. The stories of that, there are stories we can say, the stories of Tuladhara Vaishya and Dharmavyadha and many other stories are glaring examples from the text. Experiments of Tagore, Mahatma Gandhi and J. Krishnamurti, etc., to some extent remind us that aim of any kind, that aim that any kind of learning or liberation from all kinds of bondage, from socio-economic to cultural spiritual one. Only then can be achieved a real and all-pervading Swaraj, where the duality of social and spiritual is extinguished. To conclude, I would like to refer the three Upanishad, which declares, the translation is, justice, learning and teaching have to be practiced together. Ritam cha swadhyaya cha pravritne cha. Yeah, only 1 minute. Justice, learning and teaching have to be practiced together. Truth, learning and teaching have to be practiced simultaneously. Sublimation or self-control, learning and teaching have to be practiced at the same time. Tranquility of mind, learning and teaching have to be practiced at the same time. Even the duties and obligations towards strangers and guests, duties as a human being, duties of begetting offspring, and those towards coming generations have to be practiced by man in conjunction with his studies and teaching. Thank you very much.
It's there in the middle. We have the microphone, this lady. And here's another. And roll sequentially here. Either one.
Okay, my question is, Acharyaji, you have painted a very inspiring picture. The problem I see in this is that Sa Vidyaya Vimuktaya is taken from one place, Rina theory is taken from another place, Purushartha taken from a third place, and descriptions of Gurukula, even if we take the veracity of these descriptions, they are from the third or fourth place. So constructing, and then Upanishada, constructing a coherent picture out of the material taken from different sources has an assumption that the tradition is unified and coherent. Now, can we claim about the Indian tradition, either literary or philosophical or education, that it has been unified and coherent over the ages? If without this assumption, taking material from different sources and constructing a picture sounds problematic. And the second question is very small. I read it long back, Dharmapal's book. But Dharmapal's book talk more of, yes, the castes and teachers and students, but I don't remember any mention of the curriculum and pedagogy. I might be wrong, it was a long time back I read it, but I don't have in my conscious mind any comments about the what kind of the curriculum, aims of education and pedagogy was being practiced in the Pathshala system about which the book is. Thank you.
Okay, so, yes.
I'm Huma. I'm especially referring to the portion where you highlighted the sort of dynamic relationship which existed between the student and the teachers, and you've taken example from the Upanishad like that of the Shvetaketu. So my question here is, in spite of the fact that there existed a very dynamic relationship like you highlighted between the teacher and the students in that era, why only a particular image or kind of relationship became popular in the later stages? Like kind of one way relationship like that of a giver and a receiver, and the emphasis given to devotion to the teacher from the pupil. Even now, if you Google the image for most for ancient Indian education, the most popular image that you get is of a teacher sitting on a tree, near the tree, and the students with folded hands. So what kind of, I mean, it sort of shows that, you know, it was a one-way relationship and there was a lot of devotion and whatever the teacher says was right. So where is that dynamic relationship had gone, where the student can actually question the teacher, and if the teacher doesn't know, he can actually say that and send the student to some other place where he can actually learn. So what are the reasons, do you think, have sort of, you know, took us away from that dynamic relation to the one-way relationship that we emphasize now?
Okay, so we have a question about the unity or plurality of the tradition and education, and also another question about pedagogical content. This is the dynamic or relation or lack thereof. That's three. You want some more?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll have the gentleman there and then the row next to the last.
Yeah, my question basically is somewhat related to what Rohitji was also saying, in the sense of like your reference to tradition, and I'm not an expert on Indian philosophy, but there is no mention about like what were like, you know, the counter sources, or like where was there any kind of engagement with other philosophies in the sense of criticism of these kind of pedagogies, or like these kind of looking at understanding of what education is all about. Because I see that as you presented, it seems like a coherent picture, but my understanding, which is very limited, it seems that it was more messy and there was a lot of dialogue and discussion going about like what exactly is that. So representation of a tradition in that sense would be more difficult, and like I would be more interested in also knowing of what were the critical approaches to where these approaches are also criticized for their limitations, as like somewhat like Huma was pointing out. Thank you.
That's a large question. We'll have maybe two more.
Hello. My question is also related to Huma. I have a question relating to, can we anyhow separate philosophical thoughts on Indian education and sociology of it? And how it is practiced, and if we can anyway segregate these two, how do we approach that?
Okay, one final question there in the back.
Yeah, I think you talked about purpose of education as identifying the swadharma, the natural innate personality of a child. So how do you think one can find that?
By Rohit, that is there a coherent one Indian tradition? There is a coherent one Indian tradition, but not a monolithic one. We should have some differentiation between the monolithic one and a pluralistic one with some coherence within it. I have taken the different sources, but they are all coherent with each other. They all respect each other. They all discuss the problems which are there in the other text also. So I think, and sometimes they come to the same conclusions, almost broadly the same conclusions. So I think that there is a coherent tradition there, but with some differences within it. So I think that, because I have to give the picture of the overall Indian tradition, so there was not enough time and space here to discuss in detail all the other streams or the sub-streams of that. If the time would require, I could do that. And then the other question is about the curriculum in Dharampal. Yeah, it is there. Dharampal tells us which are the subjects, who are the teachers, how they are taught, that the method of teaching, that is not there actually. But it is in there, service done by the Britishers. What was the method? When this tutorial system was there, and the British followed it from here to there. That's the claim of Dharampal. But it is there in the surveys. Yeah, this is a very interesting or investigating question. That is one-way relationship, or why? What are the reasons that now this is? If you accept that in our traditional seed, the two-way relationship is there. Now, why it was not perceived in modern times, I don't know where and from what time this concept of one-way relationship emerged here. I don't know. But so far, the internal discussions were all time there. Why there are so many sects in one stream of philosophy? In one stream of philosophy, not so many streams of philosophy. Why? And up to the 19th century, if you go in the Sanskrit texts, you will find discussions about the Darwin's theory there. So they were very welcome to the new theories also, discussing the new, whether accept or not, that's a different thing. But they were very welcoming the new theories also and discussing the things. But why it happened now, that we don't know. Maybe, this is my perception, you can say, perception which is not authentic, but this is my perception, that this is actually the imperial or colonial rule in India that makes the teacher like a king, that makes the teacher like a master. It's not in our tradition. And if we think that a student or a shishya can disagree with the guru, it means that this is not one-way relationship. The third discussion with the other, I think this has been answered in this question, very much discussion with the other philosophies, Manohar, and you will find a lot of material in this, how the debates were going on, how the shastras were going on, how all, but because these were the philosophical things, so I did not include that in my paper. Separation of philosophical and social. No, there is no separation of philosophical and social. Actually, what society is a question of philosophy. If I ask the definition of society, is it a social question or a philosophical question? If I ask what a human being is it a philosophical question or a humanitarian question? So, there is a philosophy behind every concept. And if you have certain philosophical, you see in our philosophy, in every philosophy, there are three major categories. One is epistemology, the other ontology, and the teleology. So when you talk about teleology, you will have to go to the ontology. And when you talk of ontology, you will have to go to the epistemology. Because your theory of knowledge tells you what the substance is, what the reality is. And if you know what the reality is, only then you can develop your social or economic and all these institutions according to that. If you do not do that, then you come to the disease which E.F. Schumacher talking of. And now, last question. Swadharma. Yeah, some question was there about Swadharma. Somebody asked. Yeah, please repeat the question.
How to identify the Swadharma?
Yeah, I am not to identify. Guru is also not to identify. Guru is only to develop his mental and moral faculties in the student to find out what his real role is. That is Swadharma.
Thank you. Well, very good. Thank you. And thank you to both of our speakers.
Thanks to the speakers, the chair, and the audience. We'll assemble back here by 1:55. Right? Yeah. According to the schedule. Thank you.